Okay, so we're just going to give it another moment, and thanks again, all the new folks. You can just put in where you are, what your name is, and one thing you want, and then we'll start up in just a moment. I hear you on more coffee. Yeah, that's a good one. Well, okay, so I think more folks are coming in. Hopefully, they can all start to join in. Aaron Gemmel, I see you. You want everything, as always. That's typical. But why not? I think that we should all get everything. That would be the best case. So while folks continue to stream in, I'm going to kick off our official program as it is. Bear with me. We're always trying these things for the first time, even though we've done them before. So let's see if I can get us to have some graphics. And maybe even some music. No? No, of course. See, this is the thing. I didn't click the button that says share computer sound. So let's try that one more time. Ah, see, I just broke everything again. This is what happens. All right, we're gonna try this one more time and see if I can get it right. No sound? Okay, well, screw that. We tried to have some theme music, but it didn't quite work. That's okay. That is part and parcel of us trying to do these virtual Zooms. So Emily, you wanna kick us over there? It worked briefly. Okay, well, somebody heard it, so that's a good sign. I don't think, okay. Are you on that camera? It's always a little bumpy. Okay, well, great. So, well, welcome everyone. Oh, microphone, see? Microphone check, 1, 2, 1, 2. Okay, well, so I hope you can all hear me. Can you just give me a thumbs up, somebody over there? Okay, good. Well, welcome everyone. It's great to see some familiar and unfamiliar faces here this morning or afternoon or evening, wherever you are. It's been since last July that we've done these present shows. And, you know, and to be honest, it was maybe a little naive or hopeful, but I thought, hey, we're gonna go back to things being normal again. We won't need to do these online Zoom events anymore. Maybe we can all just hang out in person. And, you know, maybe I won't need to put on the same guru shirt every Sunday. I mean, you might have noticed, for those of you who were here last season, I'm not wearing the exact same shirt as I used to wear. I bought a new shirt in the meantime. But, and I'm also wearing pants, which is a great thing. But, you know, I thought that by the fall, it would be safe for us to all be together in one place and that we wouldn't feel so anxious and isolated and uncertain about the state of the world. I guess like many things, I was probably wrong about that one. I mean, here we are. And, you know, for me personally, that feeling of normalcy lasted maybe a couple months. I mean, but exactly 14 days ago, I was in Amsterdam and I met with a colleague at a museum. Everything was great. I got to see a show and, you know, no masks, no worry. I mean, in Holland, nobody wears masks at all, except on trains. But I left Holland, I came back to Berlin, where I've been, you know, here since the start of the pandemic. And I get a text from my colleague whom I met with that she tested positive for COVID. And oops, I was just exposed. And I just put my whole family at risk. And so, you know, we're lucky here in Germany, we have testing, we have tracking. And so, you know, I've been quarantined for the last 14 days and for everyone's safety. And it meant I was quarantined from my own family, took a couple of tests, which were thankfully negative. But it made me realize that, you know, everybody's been saying from the start that this pandemic is going to be worse in the fall than in the spring. You know, look at the Spanish flu of 1918. But, you know, I've heard that 100 times, but how did I forget that? I don't know. I mean, I just forgot it somehow, willfully. And maybe that's the thing. The human mind is wired for normalcy. It can take the most horrendous of circumstances, the worst traumas, and it rewires itself to accept them. It tries to develop coping mechanisms, tools to handle the worst or weirdest situations, and just continue like everything is hunky-dory. And so Yeah, sometimes resilience is good and important, but sometimes it goes too far when it keeps you from, when it keeps you just coping rather than actually acting and living differently. So, you know, sometimes I think back to art school, and, you know, I was very privileged to go to Yale and study art of all things. I mean, I was the, you know, I was a nice kid of first generation Indian immigrants, and I studied art, like, which seemed like the least practical and the most insane thing to do in the world. But, you know, that was for me a big step. And I remember something that seemed very normal back then, though now it seems insane. I mean, I remember that, you know, every semester in the graduate photography department, the professors in that department, they would choose one student to really, really, really lay into. They would rip them apart. They would make them cry. They would usually get them to drop out of the program for a semester or entirely. And at the time, that was just the way things were done. That's just what I thought art school was. And, you know, now when I look back at that, I think, is that teaching? Is that learning? I mean, it scarred me for years, but it just seemed normal. I mean, don't get me wrong, I believe that there's a real importance to critique. I mean, you know, you call it critique in art school. In other places, you might call it constructive criticism. But I think that there's a way to show people that you care for them, and then give them your perspective or feedback on their work from your perspective, but localizing it, making it clear so that it can be useful for them. I mean, someone I really admire, Richard D. Bartlett, he's a social tech entrepreneur and an organizer. He taught me a useful tool a couple months ago, which was, he said, you know, if you really disagree with something that somebody has just said, for example, let's say like you disagree with somebody about politics or religion or basic values, any of that, he said, try out saying, there's a part of me that disagrees with this specific thing that you said. You see the difference? It's like, you know, you make it clear that it's just a part of you that thinks this, but you leave yourself room to change your mind. And you're also specific about the thing that you disagree with. So that, again, you're not saying, you know, that it's about the whole person. It's about something very specific where you have room for learning, where there is the possibility that either one of you might change your mind. And I mean, this is like the total opposite of what I feel like people on the internet do these days. It's there, it's all like, all of me hates all of you. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's just, it's all about this kind of all-in hatred, canceling. And I think there's something to finding a space for conversation. I mean, last night, my wife and I were watching this documentary, this Netflix documentary, The Social Dilemma. And it's about social media and how it's basically destroying individuals, children, society at large, and how it's polarizing our politics and destroying our sense of shared reality of facts. And, you know, the way it was made was a little bit over the top. I don't know if I needed three of that dude for Mad Men all playing an AI controlling this kid's brain. Not sure about that. But it was pretty on point and very scary. And anyways, we were watching this documentary, and then my wife, she tried to start a kind of very cautious, critical conversation with me. She said, hey, Prem, how did you feel about that film? You know, what did it make you think about your own social media usage? And of course, I got all defensive. I was like, well, yeah, I mean, it makes some really good points about society, but like, I'm working on the problem. I'm trying to figure out how to bring people together on Zoom and in all these formats rather than just chatting on social media. I mean, well, actually, give me a second. I just have to get onto Instagram and like a couple of things and send a couple of direct messages to people. Yeah. And of course, that didn't go over so well. And, you know, maybe we got into a little bit of fight about that. But in the end, I had to agree with her. You know, she's right. And that's the thing. Learning is often uncomfortable. That's the thing we forget sometimes when we talk about education. Whenever you encounter something new, whenever you encounter something that's different from yourself and your way of acting in the world, unless you can relax your body, unless you can go in with an open mind, you react against it defensively. And so I think that's one of the tools that I'm trying to learn that maybe we can all learn together, how to calm our bodies down, to learn to be with others and ideas that are different so that we can actually change our minds and have other people's minds change too. So that's why I'm thrilled to be here with all of y'all today. I mean, this new season of Present is presented by Front International 2022, the Cleveland Triennial of Contemporary Art. And I see from that great chat before that a lot of you folks are hailing in from Cleveland or Akron or somewhere in Northeast Ohio, which is amazing. Because as I said, I think it's a blessing amidst all of the trauma and destruction and pain and loss that we've been having. Actually, it's more possible to be connected to certain folks in the world, and that's really beautiful. And, you know, I happen to be the artistic director of Front 2022, but, you know, I'll just say, just in case I say anything that's too wacky or crazy today, which I'm sure I will at some point, this is, you know, like Front doesn't take any problems from what I say here. This is me as Prem getting up and doing this, though Front has graciously sponsored this whole third season. And now we can do present every month and gather together folks throughout the winter and spring. And so I want to give a big shout out and thanks to Fred Bidwell, who is the director, executive director of Front and founder, to Sarah Liska. Yeah, there's Fred. To Sarah Liska, who is the deputy director and director of exhibitions. Can we, and to Allison Smith, who also plays a major role in Front on every level. There she is. They're the team at Front who make this happen. And I wanna also thank all the foundations and donors and folks who gave money to Front so that we can actually pay our special guests a little bit now. Let's have a virtual round of applause for all of that. So as I mentioned, this is gonna happen once a month on the last Sunday of every month. So pencil it into your calendars. And I hope it'll be a chance to be together, to read, to think, to discuss, to move, to write, and just to be present with each other and with folks we don't yet know. And if anybody wants to stay connected, there's a little mailing list that you can sign up for. And I think Julia, our beautiful, amazing virtual assistant, will put that into the chat. And you can feel free to use that to sign up for a mailing list if you want. Now, we have today three incredible special guests hailing in from all over. We have, first of all, we have the Brooklyn-based learner. She doesn't like to call herself an artist, but we'll talk about that in a moment. We have Kameelah Janan Rasheed. And where we are, let's have a little round of applause for Kameelah. And then we have, hailing from Cleveland, Ohio, we have the polymathic poet and musician, R.A. Washington. R.A., how you doing? What's up? And then we have from Queens, New York, we have the clinical psychologist and former artist, Tamara Sussman. And we'll get to chat with each of them over the course of the next, couple, hour and a half, hour and three quarters. And I wanna just give also a big thanks and shout out to Emily, to Presents co-producer, the professor and designer, Emily Smith here in Berlin, and also our virtual studio assistant, Maria Julia Iglesias, who is in right now in Neukölln in East Berlin. Hi. So thank you everyone. And I think you should all give yourselves a round of applause because wherever you are, you got up on a Sunday to join us on Zoom. What kind of a crazy thing is that? But hopefully we'll make it worth your time. So, great. So, before we start, I want to introduce a short embodied practice that I'm adapting from the Minneapolis-based trauma specialist, Resma Menakem. Actually, let me just get his book. His book, My Grandmother's Hands, is fantastic and really, really important reading, I think, in thinking about trauma and the body and race. Menakem recommends this particular practice for what he calls bodies of culture when they enter into an unfamiliar space. But I think that it's a useful practice for all of us to do, especially when we enter into an unfamiliar space like this one here. So I'd like you to, if you can, just take a moment and stand up wherever you are. And just take a moment and stare straight in front of you. Take a moment to just let yourself arrive in the room. Look in front of you. Take a deep breath in and let it out. And then slowly, using your shoulders and your hips, I want you to just turn
and look over your left shoulder. And then you can slowly come back to center. And then slowly turn your gaze up. And then come back to center. And look down. And come back to center. And then again, pivoting with your hips and your shoulders, just turn and look over your right shoulder. Then we can come back to center. And we're gonna put in the chat just a little excerpt from a fantastic interview that Resma Menakem did with the radio host, Krista Tippett, that grounds this practice. Okay, so let me start out by sharing my screen, and I'm going to present some of the thinking that's been bubbling up in me over the last 6 months, really. I mean, some of you have been here. Let me see, as usual, something's not right on my computer, so I'll try to ad-lib for a moment. Some of you who have been to present before have seen a lot of ideas be presented over the course of the last 6 months. But here's a couple of new ones that I'm trying to work through right now. So let's see, do you see my screen? No. Do you see my screen? Okay, that's weird, it's not. As usual, there's something going wrong. There's always something going wrong. How's that? Is that working? There you go. Third time's the charm. So, you know, it's kind of a rough sketch for my thinking around the role of the artist and art in society at this particular moment. And, you know, it comes out of one of the largest realizations that I had during the first phase of lockdown, in the midst of not going to exhibitions and museums and physical events and gatherings and all the kinds of things that I usually associate with art, but even with life, was that I think that art, its real value is actually that it's a way of communicating with other folks, that it creates community and communion with others who are different from each other. And, you know, I think that from the first cave paintings onward, art is fundamentally about communicating with someone or something else outside of yourself, or could even be a part of yourself, or other people, animals, spirits, gods. But, you know, it's about this kind of community that's created. And I think we often forget that when we think about art's value in terms of economics or its cultural value, that it brings people, and more than people, it brings actors together. And I mean, these days, in the midst of all of the crises that we're seeing around the world, I'm thinking about art at three scales of resolution. The individual, the collective, and the societal scale. And I'll try to kind of like point to these as I go through. I mean, and as a way to kind of even start thinking about scales, let me point to the polymathic writer and organizer Adrienne Murray Brown. Their book, Emergent Strategy, is a constant, you know, kind of support for my thinking. I'm constantly inspired by their work. And I'll just read this. In the framework of emergence, the whole is a mirror of the parts. Existence is fractal. The health of the cell is the health of the species and the planet. And I think it gives us a way to think about how each of our own health on a cellular and individual level bubbles up to actually impact the whole. So I'm going to start with The Artist's Way, which is a popular self-help book. It's sold millions of copies, I think 5 million. It's basically a kind of 12-week self-guided residency that people can use to develop their own creative practice. I mean, and its key ideas are it tries to get you to eliminate your inner critic who tells you that you should or shouldn't do something. It also tries to make you understand that art making, or really any creativity, is a process, not an end product. And most importantly, I think it tries to connect you with the idea that creativity is outside of yourself, that when you're actually fully in the flow of making things that are creative of any kind,
you're tapping into something much larger than yourself. And I think that this was a very commonplace idea before the rise of the idea of the genius artist. And, you know, Julia Cameron has these two tools that she recommends, and I think they're worth stating just because they're useful in many ways. One is what she calls morning pages, and essentially her recommendation is that every morning you wake up and the first thing you do before you do anything else is you write three pages by hand, stream of consciousness, without editing yourself. And, you know, the second is that is what she calls an artist's date, which is that once a week you take an hour or two and you do something alone that is like a guilty pleasure. Like you just do something you want to do, but you don't let yourself do. And, you know, for me, I mean, I actually did this artist's way on the recommendation of a friend from late April to late July. And I have to say it worked wonders. I mean, I'm either much clearer or much crazier, depending on, you know, what you think. So I'll let you all be the judge of that in the next hour and a half. But I do think what's interesting is that maybe we could even replace the artist way with just the human way. I mean, I think that these two tools, if everyone in the world had the privilege to do them, to take 30 to 40 minutes themselves every day in the morning to do something on their own and to write, to reflect, and then to spend an hour or two a week doing something for themselves, I actually think it could have great impact on individuals, but also on society at large. Because I think that, you know, in many ways, the idea of the artist itself, as the idea of the artist as a kind of troubled soul, but also as a soul genius, it represents this really particular culmination of a 500-year trajectory in the so-called West since the late Middle Ages and early Renaissance, in which artists have come to represent the apex predator within a kind of cultural and intellectual ecosystem. But I think that this is important. I think the fact that artists are allowed to become liberated individuals is actually a beautiful idea. But I think that we could go even further. What if we think of the artist not as a fixed role, but as a pathway or a transition phase to something else? What if it's a practice rather than a profession? And so to summarize this kind of first scale, I think that art making prototypes and models different tools and pathways towards individual self-knowledge and liberation. And my hope is that with this individual liberation and joy, people might be able to support others on their path towards joy. So I want to connect this to some other strands and some other books I've been reading. I mean, this whole thing made me think about Richard Sennett's 2012 book, Together, about contemporary society and cooperation. I mean, he makes the point that in childhood development, cooperation precedes individuation. Cooperation is the foundation of human development, and that we learn how to be together before we learn how to stand apart. And he also makes this really interesting point about how in music, in making music, there's a basic distinction between practicing and rehearsing. The one is a solitary experience, the other is collective. And, you know, I think that this is a fascinating way to think about practice, though I also think it hinges on the idea of a strong and inseparable distinction between the individual and the collective. And, you know, which I think that I'd like to look at this writer, Bessel van der Kolk, a psychologist and trauma specialist since about 40 or 50 years, and who points to the work of others where, you know, as he says, modern neuroscience has confirmed the notion of the mind as a kind of society. And this kind of, once we start to think about an individual themselves as already being a society, it opens things up a little bit. And, you know, as he says here, the self is like an orchestra conductor who helps all the parts to function harmoniously as a symphony rather than a cacophony. And so if we take this into account, maybe the self isn't, maybe practice, doing a thing for yourself, much like doing an artistic activity in the studio or at the home, maybe it's also a communal rehearsal, just at a different scale, in which you activate different parts of yourself, making you more able to communicate with others. I want to point to the activist and writer Audre Lorde, whose essay, The Uses of the Erotic, is fantastically inspirational. And she has this great quote: "The sharing of joy, whether physical, emotional, psychic, or intellectual, forms a bridge between the sharers, which can be the basis for understanding much of what is not shared between them and lessens the threat of their difference." And this leads me to my kind of second point about art, which is that I think art is one, it's not the only one, but it's one very particularly powerful modality for creating rich, complex, and aesthetically pleasurable experiences, which can make it easier to encounter ideas and people that are challenging and discomforting, things that might seem threatening at first, but from which one can learn collectively. So the third scale is the societal scale. And, you know, one of my favorite writers, someone who has influenced Adrienne Murray Brown, but many, many others also, is science fiction author Octavia E. Butler. And, you know, her prescient novel, The Parable of the Sower, was first published in 1993. And it's set in 2024, just 4 years from now, in a near future dystopia of America. And, you know, in the words of the artist Connie Samaras, Parable of the Sower is like a preface for the now. And, you know, the book depicts a world that feels awfully close to things we're already seeing. Massive inequality, environmental degradation, man-made and natural fires across a lot of the West, increasing violence, the aftermath of a plague, water scarcity, and much worse. And maybe this is why Parable has hit the New York Times bestseller lists over the last several weeks and months. And, you know, the teenage protagonist of Parable of the Sower, Lauren Oya Olamina, she lives in a lower middle class gated community outside of Los Angeles that's trying to shield itself from the outside world. And, you know, the community's elders are in denial about the state of the world outside. They believe that things are going to be okay. And she, on the other hand, is convinced that they cannot continue to live in denial, that they have to start to teach themselves skills to survive outside of their gated community. So she starts to gather people around her who will seek to kind of grow and learn together to survive. And she starts to write down her principles into a new kind of belief system. And I'll just read this. This is the first entry in the book from her Earthseed, The Books of the Living. "Prodigy is, at its essence, adaptability and persistent, positive obsession. Without persistence, what remains is an enthusiasm of the moment. Without adaptability, what remains may be channeled into destructive fanaticism. Without positive obsession, there is nothing at all." And, you know, I don't want to, I'll come back to this for a second. I'll just say, you know, I think of the protagonist, Lauren Oya Olamina, as being almost a proto-artist. I mean, this is one of the best descriptions of art I can find in the world. And I think of her as an individual who rejects the orthodoxy and illusions of those around her, who prototypes and publishes her own belief system as tools for others. And she collects strategies and people together to form community and to form a new way of life. And I don't want to spoil the book, but let's just say that Lauren is unfortunately true. Her community is burned down and she must leave with those who survive to try to forge a new world. And this is like a kind of hard cut transition to the very last paragraph of Bessel van der Kolk's The Body Keeps the Score, this fantastically inspirational book for me. And, you know, I'll just read from this. "Many of our most profound advances grew out of experiencing trauma. The abolition of slavery from the Civil War, Social Security in response to the Great Depression, and the GI Bill, which produced our once vast and prosperous middle class from World War II. Trauma is now our most urgent public health issue, and we have the knowledge necessary to respond effectively. The choice is ours to act on what we know." And I'll read one more quote from Parable of the Sower. "Civilization is to groups what intelligence is to individuals. It is a means of combining the intelligence of many to achieve ongoing group adaptation. Civilization, like intelligence, may serve well, serve adequately, or fail to serve its adaptive function. When civilization fails to serve, it must disintegrate unless it is acted upon by unifying internal or external forces." And, you know, in my mind, this is the kind of third scale of why art is useful. I mean, art is art can function like a kind of Trojan horse. Art has access today to people with economic, social, and political power. And so art can help to prototype and demonstrate for those who are in power and can make structural change or help it along, can offer different ways to transform society for the betterment of everyone. And I think that, you know, this allows me a way to say, I think that rather than thinking about the artist as a sole genius, a solo maker who wants to only be alone and be creative, I think we might start to think about the artist as a liberated individual who wants, whose pleasure it is to support other individuals to be liberated in order to create new worlds, to shape new societies, to shape societies of difference, societies of learning, societies of healing, and societies of joy. And I think that's also why we're all here together for Present. I mean, it's an idea of bringing together different folks all together and in dialogue. Just as a little bit of a coda, I want to come back to Bessel van der Kolk and The Body Keeps the Score. I mean, he makes some mysterious and fascinating connections that, for example, he has a whole chapter on EMDR, eye movement desensitization and reprocessing therapy. Maybe we'll have a chance to talk later with Tamara Sussman about this, but it's an experimental, but for me, very compelling form of therapy, almost like magic. But it essentially has somebody think of a traumatic memory, and then the therapist moves their finger left and right in a particular rhythm as the person thinks about the memory. It almost, to me, this is the layperson, but it feels almost like hypnosis. But it also apparently has a relationship to REM sleep and the way our eyes move. But it's fascinating. It doesn't even require talking about the therapy. It doesn't even require trusting the therapist. And yet it can still work to help you to reintegrate traumatic memories into your life narrative. And, this is a, you know, seeing novel, to allow you to see connections between the trauma and the rest of your life. And seeing novel connections is the cardinal feature of creativity, as we've seen. It's also essential to healing. And this, to me, is a really remarkable key for the connection between dreams, therapy, healing, and the connections between folks. So when I first was reading Bessel van der Kolk talk about EMDR, I also happened to read a book of literary theory on narrative form called Meander, Spiral, and Explode by Jane Allison. And there was this one passage that struck me. Discourse comes from discuro, to run back and forth, to think of your eyes reading lines on this page. The back and forth of your eyes as you read. It's suspiciously similar to me to the back and forth eye movement that Bessel van der Kolk describes. And it made me think, could reading trigger something akin to a dreaming state? A state where creativity is opened up and the mind can make new connections? A space where trauma can be reintegrated into a larger life or social narrative and where we can begin to heal? And so just to conclude this beginning part, this first part of today's event, before we bring on all of our fantastic guests, I want to share a final text, a short but powerful poem by Langston Hughes. It's actually inspired the name of Front International 2022, but we chose this over a year ago, I think a year and a half ago almost. But I find myself rereading it almost every single day these days. And so it speaks very simply and plainly to pain, to trauma, to destruction and healing, but without making the claim that this is easy or even necessarily, you know, a straightforward or hopeful process. But I'd like to ask you all, I mean, in Zoom, we're so trapped in our screen, but if you like, stand up wherever you are, stand up. And if you like, you can unmute yourself. I'd like to ask us to read this together, if you like, so that we can become a chorus rather than a single voice. Take a moment, if you like, stand up and we can read together. Two somewhat different epigrams. You with me? Mm-hmm. Let's try it. Oh, God of dust and rainbows, help us see that without dust the rainbow would not be. I look with awe upon the human race and God, who sometimes spits writs right in its face. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone. So, okay, that was a lot of input. I know that was a lot to take in over the last 30 minutes. So I think it's very useful to move between the collective and the individual modes. I think they're both important. I think it's important to be a good individual in order to be a good part of a collective, as the artist Grace Derito once said to me. So I would love to propose a short exercise now for the next 3 minutes. Do you all have a piece of pencil and a paper, or, you know, or can you type on your computer? I'd like us to do a very short exercise that is called Wild Mind by Natalie Goldberg, that comes to me via my co-producer, Emily Smith. So if you like, just take a moment to take a deep breath and let it out. And another deep breath. Let it out. And finally, another deep breath. And let it out. And I'm going to set an alarm for 3 minutes. Just take a moment to actually write whatever comes to mind uncensored for yourself. Wild mind for 3 minutes. Okay? Let's go. Okay, so I think just wherever you are, pick up your pen or your finish your sentence or thought,
transition from here. Okay. So thank you all for going on that little journey with me. We're now going to welcome our first special guest, Kameelah Janan Rasheed. Okay, so.
Hey, everyone.
Hi.
I'm just sharing my screen. Can we see my screen?
Absolutely.
Very great. Thanks everyone for having me. I'm Kameelah Janan Rasheed and I'm based in Brooklyn, New York, but I'm from a small town called East Palo Alto up in Northern California. And I like to shout out my town because everyone thinks if you're from California, then you're from San Francisco or from Oakland, but I'm from East Palo Alto. So I'm really excited to be here. Prem invited me and we were trying to figure out like, what should I talk about? What should I present? And his first note was for me to slow down as I'm speaking. So I'm going to constantly remind myself of that. And the second note is we were talking a lot about writing and what does it mean to author things and what does it mean to be engaged in a practice that's collaborative. So today I want to talk about ecology and collaborative writing. And I wanted to think about that in the context of my own practice. And we're actually going to like do some stuff. So I'm going to talk very briefly and then we're going to do some stuff together. That's going to be around collaborative writing. But I just wanted to set some context. So again, I'm Kameelah, and I think about my practice as something that's ecological, which means that I'm trying to create these ecosystems of iterative and provisional projects. And I think often about Alexis Pauline Gums, who I met several years ago on the internet. And she's written so many amazing things. And one of the things that I'm constantly drawn to is her idea of ancestry co-written texts, or this idea of how we can think about the things we produce as constitutive of an ecosystem of processes and people rather than being solely authored. And so a lot of what I do in my practice is sort of thinking about how do I build networks between ideas and processes, and how do I learn alongside other people so that we can create this like beautiful tentacular network of ideas and experiences. And so I was like, oh, I'm definitely going to forget some things. So I just wanted to put up a couple of things that have been sort of percolating in my brain as I think about this. And so part of that has to do with this notion of grappling with the poetics and the politics. And I would also add the word pleasures of the things that are unfinished. So thinking about this poetics of revision. And I think about this a lot when I think about the idea of living, particularly when it comes to Black people. So these notions of Black living being connected to these notions of revision and unfinished. And what does it mean to sort of leak across time, to leak across genres, to leak across disciplines, to leak across species. And I'm constantly brought back to Alexis Pauline Gums again, who also talks about and in archive this notion of letting this text be as alive as you are alive. Or Octavia Estelle Butler, who in a 1994 interview with Samuel Delaney talks about this notion of primitive hypertext, or this role of her sort of learning by allowing herself to drift through many genres and activities. So I wanna just keep coming back to this idea of leakiness. Like, what do we mean by leakiness? And leakiness is super important to me as both a spiritual practice but as an artistic practice. And I wouldn't say the spiritual and the artistic are separate. So one of my favorite poets is Emily Dickinson, which often surprises people, but I don't know why. But I love Emily Dickinson. She's from a problematic period in history and has her own problematic history herself. But one of the things that I really enjoy about her practice is her sort of refusal to, I guess, nest herself within certain forms that didn't seem to give her much freedom in how she expressed her ideas. And so this is from a letter that she was writing to Thomas Higginson, who was one of the editors at The Atlantic in the 1860s. And they're going back and forth about editing her poems and like what they, if they make sense. And so she writes this note to him, which I think she's trolling him. And most other folks who have commented on this think that she's trolling him. She says, "Are these more orderly? I thank you for the truth. I had no monarch in my life and cannot rule myself. And when I try to organize, my little force explodes and leaves me bare and charred. I think you called me wayward. Will you help me improve? And so there's sort of like this moment where she's like, yeah, please help me gather myself, even though it's going to hurt me in the process, please help me organize myself. And so whenever I think about this idea of leakiness, I often come back to this notion as well. What does it mean to organize yourself as a way to prevent leakiness? But also, what are the potentials of leakiness? What are the potentials of spilling out? What are the potentials of staying outside the container or refusing a container altogether? And so, in thinking about all that, I consider learning to be the container itself, the thing that exceeds the container, the reaction between the leakage or spillage and the substrate it encounters. Learning is all of these things, right? The moment of being inside of a particular genre or discipline, sort of like pushing yourself out of that or just being pushed out of that, or the in the reaction between that moment of sort of falling out of a container or leaving a container and encountering another substrate. So these are all part of our learning processes. And so Prem introduced me as a learner because for a long time I kept saying I'm an artist and I was like, well, I do other stuff. So is that art or is that just me hanging out with people and thinking? But is that art? I don't know what it is. But I knew one thing that was common was that I was learning every single time. And I was learning because I was interested in what does it mean to learn alongside other people. I'm sure it has to do with the fact that I spent most of my life as a teacher and still teach and do curriculum development. But I was like, what is the common thread in everything that I do? I like learning with others. I like learning on my own. I like learning. And so learning is literally linked to leakiness, and it's a refusal to close oneself off from the influence of the past, influence of the present, or influence from the future. But it's also a refusal to close yourself off from influence from other species, influence from other religions, influence from other ways of making sense of the world. And I know in many ways, I had a bit of a head start. I grew up in a pretty syncretic religious family. My parents converted to Islam in the 80s. I went to Catholic high school. I had a good friend who was Mormon and I went to her school dances and had tons of Christian friends and went to their services. So for me, leakiness is like, that's just what you do. You just sort of leak and just, you kind of just flow where it goes and it makes sense. And so in thinking about leakiness, I think about to be a learner means to not close yourself, to refuse to be a closed figure. It also means that you are allowing yourself to be influenced, not to be overwhelmed, but you're allowing yourself to understand that possibly you don't know everything. And this is just an image from a worksheet that I was looking for a math curriculum thing. And they have this image. It said, can't find the perimeter because it's a closed figure. And I was like, wow, that's perfect. This notion is you can't find the perimeter. You can't define a thing that refuses to be defined by the notion that it must be closed. So I'm gonna wrap up really quickly and show you some examples of like leakiness before I ask you guys to do something. But with regard to this notion of leakiness and revision, I wanna like give a shout out to my dad because I think implicitly he was the first person who ever taught me about leakiness in the poetics of revision. When he converted to Islam in the 80s, one of the ways that he learned is that he would type his notes on the back of his pharmacy school homework, but he would photocopy pieces of the Quran and other holy texts, paste them in, and then write notes on top of them. And I'm sure some people will find this a bit sacrilege, like how dare you cut out the Quran and write on top of it. But this was my dad's learning process, this idea of commenting, annotating, emendating, making clear they're learning alongside something else. So this paratext is super important. And this is an excerpt from my book, No New Theories, which was published a second time because the first time there are some errors. And so in the second edition of the book, we thought spent a lot of time thinking about what does it mean to show revision as something that is open and public and not something to be scared of or ashamed of. Quick notes on the observable universe. I could talk about the observable universe forever, but it's just a quick note to all of us that what we know is so, so minuscule in comparison to what we don't know. Any attempt to say that we know anything is probably just not a good idea. So whenever I'm about to say something with great certainty and confidence and arrogance, I constantly come back to this image to say, the observable universe is what we know with our limited perceptual capabilities, which means there's even more that we don't know that we don't know because of our limited perceptual capabilities and then our limited communication capabilities, which means that anytime we announce anything about the world, it is based on an announcement of very, very limited understanding. So I'm gonna skip ahead quickly because I want to make sure that we get to the doing of things. This is a quick note from Wikipedia, who probably accidentally gave us a poetic statement for their dynamic list, which is, this is a dynamic list and may never be able to satisfy your particular standards for completeness. And so this is a good thing to hold in your heart whenever you're getting overwhelmed, that even Wikipedia, a worldwide encyclopedia, knows that it's impossible to ever be complete, and we should think about learning it that way. So really quickly, just to give you guys some context for what you guys are gonna be doing with me today, I wanted to show you guys a couple of projects that are thinking about writing as an ecosystemic collaborative process. So this is from Brooklyn Public Library in early 2019. It was a project called Scoring the Stacks. It was thinking about choreography through architecture and what does it mean to invite people to move through a library space as wandering as a mode of research or a mode of learning. And so there are these cards on the table. These cards gave people a list of certain things they could do, like find a blue book, read the last page, write down the word you like to use in a future conversation. They wrote these words down. We collected them, and then we had a bunch of workshops where we took everything we collected and then made stuff. So this is from a workshop with Morgan Basicus, a dear, dear, dear friend, where we together wrote and performed and recorded a song all in 90 minutes using the words that we collected. There's also something that I did at Wendy's Subway, which was quite similar, of having people sort of browse text in their area, and using that text, we together wrote out this large leaky sentence. This is from a workshop up in Petersboro where folks were working on the same task of gathering words from the library through these different scores, and then we're submitting a collaborative writing this one. And I'm gonna pause to read this one because I think it's sort of spectacular. What does the world look like in 2045? Back when Facebook had become a town and George H.W. Bush was scarcely starting from scratch in the oil business, she was a stay-at-home type and not about to lose her children. Surviving together with her sisters, they shared funny stories, feeling secure, and stitching social relationships standing forever. And this just came out of the collection of words that they got from the library. This is from a program that I did at Williams College on eschatology, or the study of the end of the world, where they browse the library to look for words and then started to put together these stories describing the end of the world. Russia and Britain gets blamed for a lot in these. And this is from a workshop with some young girls in Vancouver, where they wrote out a bunch of sentences, and then I took them all and then I put them together into a piece which reads, I created a team of fictional superheroes over and over again. You're staring into an orange shore. I guess it can't hurt. A green waterfall defeats the big container. What's below you? Tame it with this game. She is about to give up. This is the last round. When is the right time to say hello? The world is a giant backstory. After the sentence, justice is what I want. And then finally, I'll just show you an example of thinking about collaboration between like oneself and a text, and thinking about sort of chance-oriented writing, where you sort of like think about your hand as a planchette and sort of spiritualist movements. Where does your finger lie, and using where your finger lies as the inspiration for what you actually end up writing. So we're gonna speed ahead. We're gonna get straight into us doing something. You see this bright pink screen. I'm gonna ask for everyone to find a text near you, any text near you. And by text, it could be an iMessage, it could be a book, it could be an open email, it could be any text, anything that has words on it, okay? And then I'm gonna ask for everyone in the chat to type in four words from this text. So type in four words from this text. We're gonna take about a minute to do this, and it's important to think about not trying to belabor like looking for the perfect word. Just find four words. Any four words will do. I'm gonna open up the chat to make sure that you guys are doing it. And I would say the fun and actually scary thing about a lot of this is that For any of these activities to work, people actually have to participate. And it can be, yes, RA Watson can be any text you want. Being a high school teacher prepares you for the embarrassment of non-participation very well. The number of times I've stood in front of a group of lovely 15-year-olds who decided that today was the day they were gonna make me cry. So I feel very prepared for these moments, but I'm seeing we're getting a couple of things in here. I'm gonna give us about 30 more seconds to put in your four words. See some great stuff. Good field notes, durable, plastic, restricted, club, new, reconnected, Chicago, criminality, spectrum. I wanna know what you guys are reading. Softly eases, sneezes, save, control, incandescent, some music, movement, and group karaoke. I love it. Okay. 15 seconds. Wild mind, live free. 10 seconds. New set of priorities. Awesome. 5 seconds. If you didn't get your words in, now is your chance. You're going to feel so sad if you don't participate. You're going to feel like, oh my goodness, what did I miss out on? The anorexic February trees. Whoa, that's already its own poem. Yes, yes, yes. Awesome. So we're going to pause here. We are closed with contributing words, but we will all have a chance to still be part of this process later. What's going to happen now is that you guys are going to vote on what I should do with these words that you all offered. So as the other presentations are going on, I'm going to be in the background trying to quickly put something together to then present to you guys at the end. So a poll is about to populate or show
should
up
I,
on your
should, go should ahead. I do it?
Yep. And it asks you 3 options. What do you want Kameelah to do with the words that you offered? I can create 7 questions. I can create an origin story, or I can describe what the world will be like in 20 years. And I can only use the words you gave me. And of course I can use filler words like the and end, but these are the limitations that I have. Alrighty.
So are people voting?
People are definitely voting.
Okay.
It seems like people want me to be a prophet of some sort and decide what the world is gonna look like in 20 years.
Artists are prophets.
We also, so right now, I feel like you're not supposed to tell people what the polls are saying in process, because it's actually, I was already sharing it. It's over. This is not like the November 3rd election. So we can be a little bit more lax. When we get to November 3rd, we cannot be that lax. But in this context, we'll be lax. Let's take about another 30 seconds to vote. It looks like right now we have 23 of 35 votes, which means 65% people have voted. But let's see if there's the possibility that possibly more people can get in there.
I think it's possible that folks on phones can't vote.
That's correct. And I see that Gina Washington is currently writing on the screen, and I don't know
what that means. I think she's saying number 2.
Oh, number 2. Got it. Okay, got it. I see.
Thank you, Gina Washington. All right, so we can add that into the... Thank you, Gina. That was a clever way to...
I love it. All righty. So the polls are closing at 1:30. Here's what we have. So create 7 questions got 25% of the votes. Create an origin story got 33% of the votes, and describe what the world would be like in 20 years got 42% of the votes. So I'm gonna go away, and while I'm away, I'm gonna figure out what the world is gonna look like in 20 years using just the words you provided for me. And I will see you all in about like 40 minutes, Prem? About 40 minutes?
Yeah, it's like 40, 45 minutes. Yeah, perfect, 40 minutes.
Awesome, thank you so much for hanging out with me.
Thank you, Kameelah.
Bye.
Thank you so much. Let's have a round of applause for Kameelah. Wait, can you turn off your screen sharing?
I sure can. There you go.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Kameelah. That's amazing and inspiring. So I can't wait to see what Kameelah has for us on her way back. So let me, in the meantime, then bring on our second guest, R.A. Washington. Let's have a round of applause for R.A. Washington. Hailing from Cleveland and... here, a poet and polymathic writer, musician, and more. Thank you for joining us. I mean, R.A., it's been such a pleasure getting to know you over the last year or so, year and a half, something like that. And I wanted to ask you first, before we chat for a little bit, you wrote this fantastic poem, this fantastic poem that has stayed with me. That you wrote originally for a front event back in May that never happened, a drive-in theater that I guess
We thought that we could get together in person. It didn't quite work. And I was hoping you might be able to read it out for us. And we will also put this into the chat so that other folks can download it or read it afterwards if they like.
Cool. In a side about the poem, I didn't realize this. When the prompt happened, the Nikita Gale prompt happened, I know the Nikita, but I didn't know it was Nikita Gale. A friend of mine is very close to them, and I always heard Nikita, 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 but I never put together that it was Nikita Gale and this Nikita until yesterday. So that's just wild to me. quote, the crowd is now at least a temporarily obsolete social technology, Nikita Gale. When the historians write about this time, it will be framed by the children not yet born, or the ones so new that they do not understand why they cannot hug Nana or see their friends aside from distant waves screens. The new in the universe will decide. And even in a reckoning where rupture is abound, we can still dream of what sky can mean. And yes, in this time, there's work being done. Art is made, songs are crafted, food is stocked, trucks are driven, takeout is delivered. We work in our homes or we have no work. We teach our children, check in on loved ones. There's work being done. So we gather toward eco-futures, we stream, listen to the news, taking each day as it comes. Ground has shifted, so we honor the ground. We hope, we make, invent new magic toward connection, and dream of skies awash in stars, each a blink and cherish. We look toward the night with a child's dreaming eyes.
Thank you, R.A. I mean, every time I hear that poem, it triggers something else in me. It's really beautiful. For everybody, we just copied a link into the chat where you can download an image of that if you want to read it afterwards. Well, thank you so much for reading that, R.A., and for being with us today. I wanted to just start by asking, I mean, you wrote that poem in May of 2020 in Cleveland, I take it, and just, you know, I guess I wanted to just start with, how is it for you? I mean, you work between so many different things. I mean, you seem endlessly active between writing, music, video, you know, poetry, publishing. But I just wanted to ask, how have you been impacted over these last several months? And look, when writing these kinds of poems, how has your framework for them changed as a creator?
It hasn't, it's changed, but it's not because of COVID. Like about 18 months ago, I found myself like literally not able to find any like work. You know, I wasn't getting any of like residencies or any teaching or any kind of speaking engagements. I also wasn't touring any music, and I was like, what am I gonna do for money? And I thought about it, and I was like, you know, maybe I'll just sit outside and busk poems, like write poems on the spot, and people can pay me whatever they got, and I'll just write poems. And it's been transformational because it's really untethered me to the concept of the artist and of the poet and some of my young person dreams about writing. You know, wanting to win the Yale Younger Poets Prize or any of those kind of like accomplishments. And it just kind of made me feel like perhaps I was meant to be more of a service worker, a sort of like lexiconic translator of sorts or an emotional translator. And not really playing the field of professional writer. And it was just, it just freed everything up, man. So I went into COVID time completely in my, like, learning my body and being in my body and, like, learning about myself and taking the time to kind of, like, figure out why these ambitions had persisted so long from, like, age 17 to 45, you know? And it's been great.
I mean, there's a comment in the chat from Suzanne Andrus, which is how transformed our society would be if we did view art as a social service. And I think that's, it's like, when you say that, I think it resonates so strongly, how much when one is maybe younger or thinking about art from a certain perspective, you think, oh, it's about me and it's about making these things. But actually, if it transformed into being a service, like maybe we could be happier doing it and it would have more value for others.
Oh, totally. Like you're sending poems out to journals and you know, you find yourself liking posts on Twitter or Instagram or one of the social media sites of other poets, mainly not really taking in what they're saying, but making sure that the community that follows them sees you engaging as the poet in this kind of game. And just as a Black man who has no higher education, you know, and playing in art fields, I was never gonna get invited anyway, the structure that it is. And it was foolish of me to go down that path, but I think young people just kind of think that it'll be all right. And I was feeling like I wasn't a good artist. Like I didn't write well. And it's just nice to be free of that. It's just opened my heart up in a way that just, I don't know. I just feel like I'm making the best of a really shitty situation. And yeah.
Well, it is, I mean, it's also, like you said, it's like you, I mean, there's a way in which, without being defeatist, it's almost like you can't control the thing as much as you control your reaction to it. You're shaking your head with a kind of like, not quite, don't believe it.
No, well, I don't know. Like, I just had my head exploded by Kameelah. So I don't want, I just learned something that was so gracious about how small we are and what we know. And it's just like one of those moments where I was like, oh, you know, because I'm trying to untether myself from my male presenting boyness. I feel like...
Can you unpack that a little bit? What do you mean by that?
I'm a heteronormal Black man with a large body. So when I come into the room, there's assumptions being made and I'm assuming things about how I'm being engaged and taken in. And then even if you tell someone, well, you know, I am this, this, and this, they do not believe you. They assume their stereotype or archetype or then you just, in order to live, you begin to take on these masks and you begin to tether yourself to a maleness and a patriarchalness, and you become an enforcer to a patriarchy trying to kill you in your own communities, you know. And you know, I make hip hop music in addition to other genres, but when you make hip hop, you know, there's a certain lexiconic thing. It's a very misogynist leaning kind of swag, kind of braggadocious vibe. And it was necessary for it to begin. But the community, and I can't speak for everyone's community, but, within my community, they're asking male presenting Black folk to pro up, to meet to meet the moment and change our language and take in a different way and not be so harmful, not be enforcers to the things trying to kill us. And I feel like I've helped in being an enforcer, and not necessarily just in my personal life amongst my relationships, but with the art I was making or the silence I was having in moments where I should have not been silent about a certain comment or a certain way someone was presenting or so yeah, not to go too far on that tangent, but I'm really trying to do a lot of more inner work so I can show up for this moment. And as my goddaughter says, you know, not hurt the youth with the language I create.
Do no harm, I guess, or do less harm. I mean, what I do also, I mean, I'm really happy to hear also of the way that, I mean, it's strange when you put something like this together, you're not always sure what the connections are until they happen, but then seeing Kameelah think about words and you're talking about being a translator in a certain way makes so much sense. I mean, I'm curious in your position as being a, I don't even know what to call you, an artist, a poet, a poly, I'm gonna call you polymath because I think that you have deserved that, you have earned that role. In fact, I think everybody should be called a polymath, but that's a whole nother question.
The whole polymath thing is, you know, Samuel Delaney was the first person I ever noticed get demand to be described that way. And between James Baldwin and Samuel Delaney, like those are my totems, like as I was growing as a thinker, as a person. And I met Samuel Delaney at some writers conference at Cleveland State University, and I somehow scammed my way into this conference. And they read one of my novel drafts as part of the workshops. And he said to me, would you write this novel if there was no chance for it to be published? And if you would you write another one and another one and another one and another one and another one? And if you cannot answer that for yourself, you'll never get published. And I was like, I watched how he was talking to the other people, the socially constructed whites in the room. And I was like, you're not talking to them like that. You know? So it was like one of those things, like, is this an old black man trying to gatekeep me out because they only let one of us in at a time? Or, you know, I really didn't understand what he meant. And now I do. And it's just, you know, that polymath thing, I'm claiming my space because, you know, why not? It's my space. I get to claim it. You know, so I've heard a lot of pushback because I put it in my bio. I finally got the courage up to put it in the bio. You know, and proled up and made a curriculum vitae and all that kind of stuff. And I was like, you know what? I'm putting this in the bio. I don't care. And I've been trying not to get red in the face when I hear it.
Yeah, well, I'm glad you're doing it because I think it does. It's like for a lot of folks, it is actually like on the one hand, some folks are often taught to not take up space, and other folks just take up space because it's what's natural. It's like breathing. And I actually think that there's something to claiming that, to calling yourself a thing, and then to having other people pick up on the fact that it's a perfectly apt way to describe what you do across so many different things and the ways in which you've touched the lives of folks in Cleveland and beyond. I want to ask that there's one question from the audience, I guess. I think it came to me privately, but I'll just open it up for one last question. for now, and then we'll have hopefully a couple minutes at the end for other questions. Suzanne Andres also asked, how do we get our American society to be open to receiving poetry, to receiving its healing?
I don't know. I don't know what American society could do, because I found myself feeling like I'm not part of American society. So I've ceased to be concerned with American society. So I don't know. And in this moment where I feel rage and grief bubbling up, I don't really know if I know to care what American society will do. I do know that I've been able to sit with people in death with poems. I've been able to celebrate birth with poems, birthdays, longing. You know, I've written maybe 700 commissioned poems where people will just pay whatever they want to me for a poem, and I mail it to them over the course of COVID. And I've been able to sit with 700 different people in different moments of emotion, personal or otherwise. And it's been a tremendous blessing, and it's made me more humble, and it's made me more quiet, and so I don't know. I don't know what American society and poets can do, but I know what this poet will do from now on. I will do this. I will write for people when they ask for me to write for them, and I will not trouble myself with the business of poetry.
Thank you, Ari. It's actually beautiful. I mean, I think this one-to-one communication and even moving outside of the mode of thinking there's some one view of society is actually a beautiful way to think about communion on different scales. So we will have the opportunity to listen to a song later in today's session by Mourning a Black Star, a band that Ari helped form and that is one of your many projects. But I just want to say thank you. Thanks for joining us today. And
thanks for having me.
I love these conversations. So
I just want to give some flowers to Kameelah. You just, thank you.
Well, so thanks, Ari, and then we will bring our third and final guest before Kameelah rejoins us with the result of her prolific making. We have our third guest, Tamara Sussman from Queens, and as I said, last but definitely not least. Tamara, thanks for joining us. I mean, there is a little bit of a backstory, right? I mean, like, Tamara is, I think my mom was here for a little bit. I think she left. So otherwise I'd say my mom is the person in this Zoom meeting who would have known me the most, the longest. But actually, Tamara has the, you know, I don't know if it's an honor or dishonor of having known me the longest. We went to art school together. So we actually studied together, and I was, just full disclosure, I was completely jealous because when I entered college, it was really hard to get into photography classes, and Tamara somehow managed as a freshman to have a portfolio of color photographs she had printed in high school that were beautiful and got into photography without a problem. And but then we became really good friends, and now you are no longer an artist in a way, or I guess I asked you if I was allowed to call you a former artist. You are a clinical psychologist. You are an assistant professor. You are a person who actually makes the work of individual healing in some ways your work. I hope that, you know, so full, you know, but I do think that it's an important contextualization, because I think this this like role of art and therapy and their connection. I mean, I'm just curious if you can tell us a little bit about, for you, how it was to start having studied art and even getting a master's degree in art and doing all of this work in the field, but then transitioning into something that seems totally different, like the world of clinical psychology.
So what was it like to make that shift?
Yeah, and like what was, you know, I'd love to hear about that.
It's definitely super different. They're two very different contexts. I think I found RA was kind of, you know, bringing up the economic realities of trying to live a life of creating, doing creative work. And I found it was like really hard for me to make money in the art world. And that was part of what, so I guess what I found myself spending like a lot of time working in order to just support a little bit of time being able to be creative. And that felt, that was like difficult because I wanted to be able to spend, I wanted the way that I made money and you know, like doing something that I really believed in to kind of come together and be one thing. So I was making a lot of art that was sort of about, that was sort of involved in asking the question of like, how you connect to other people, how you know when you're really able to connect and truly understand each other. Artwork that was trying to do things like describe a really specific emotion or a really specific experience, and then to the point where somebody else could kind of have that experience. And then what I realized was that people are doing that, you know, people were doing that kind of work, but from a scientific perspective, in addition to like, you know, artistically. And I discovered that if I kind of took that path instead, that I could kind of bring together the work that I want to do and maybe get paid for it at the same time. So that was kind of what inspired me. But it's a super different world. I think that like in creative circles, authorship is thought about very, very differently than in a scientific or, you know, like in the psychology world. I think the value that's placed on somebody's individual perspective, that's like a lot of value is placed on that in the art world. And there is a lot less value placed on that in the scientific community.
Well, I think it's something that even came up today. Like if we think about what Kameelah was mentioning and how, you know, actually there are all of these ways of making art that might be collaborative, of writing that are collaborative, but it's true. I mean, in the scientific world, I mean, I guess, like, how do you feel about the role of like ego within the kind of psychology world, if that's fair to ask?
Sure. I mean, I think one thing that I was always really bad at in the art world is like promoting myself and you know, trying to like, which I think is key if you are going to be engaged with that, you have to be comfortable with that on some level. And I think that I'm not so comfortable with that. And so in that way, and especially like in therapy, right? Like in therapy, everything you do, the successes, it's actually all like, confidential, like you literally can't even tell anybody else about it. And I think coming from having felt like this pressure to be able to do this thing that like doesn't come naturally to me, which is like to, you know, promote my work or like whatever, that like going into coming into a context where like some of the work that I do is actually like it would be unethical for me to share it felt really like freeing in a way.
I mean, but that's so, I mean, it's interesting because it changes the terms of what success is in the sense of like, you know, if like, whereas as, you know, even RA was touching upon, if like one mode of success, maybe a problematic one is like, okay, are you able to be like visible and have all these things in the arts? I mean, what constitutes, like what for you is like a kind of good day, or what does it mean to like, you know, how do you judge that?
Right. And so I think like what's, I know that you're, so I do two things, right? Like I do research and then I do therapy. So, and they have very different kinds of like ideas of what a good day is, right? But a good day therapeutically, like when I'm working with clients, is that, you know, like somebody tells me that they're doing better, that, you know, that they like kind of can see a few things that have really changed in their life as a result of the work that we've done together. Like that to me feels so good. And you mentioned, like, I think related to something about like feeling like a wizard or feeling like you have this magical capability. And with some of the disorders like PTSD, which you brought up, like in, cause you were talking about that book, The Body Keeps the Score. PTSD is something that I specialize in treating, and it's something that like you can make a huge amount of progress in when you're working with somebody, and seeing those like really dramatic transformations is incredibly rewarding and feels like, you know, so that would make it a really good day when you see somebody really like turn a corner.
I mean, in that way, yeah, the kind of idea of almost like again, coming back to this idea of service is really interesting, and how you operate within that. I mean, I'm curious for you in your work. I mean, one of the things, I think my mom is not here, which is probably cool. I love that my parents come to these. I always invite them to these. But then like there are moments where, you know, I remember when I first started to think about going into therapy, you know, I don't know, 12 years ago, 15 years ago, you know, I knew it was a thing that there was such a stigma attached to it. Like in my own family, it was, you know, coming from a kind of Hindu family, Indian immigrants, it was like, A, like the idea that you would spend money to talk to a person seemed crazy in itself. Like the idea that you couldn't just talk about those things with your family or the community, and that you needed to do that seemed really crazy. So it was almost like there was all of these things where I had so many people telling me for a long time, like, why would you go into therapy? That doesn't make any sense. And I'm curious if you, like, did you come into it with any stigma attached to it? Or how do you address that when you find that people do have, you know, a lot of reasons to be, or even like unethical behavior with therapists, which I've heard some really bad behavior recently. I'm just curious what you think about the stigma around therapy as a profession and as a practice.
Okay, right. Okay, so I feel like there's like a few different strands of what you just brought up. One is like stigma, like broadly speaking, like stigma against therapy. So this idea that like in order to be in treatment, there must be something really wrong with you, and that kind of marks you as somebody who has like a big problem or is crazy or like something like that. And so there's that stigma. I think that, you know, like it, right, like that stigma is greater and lesser in different contexts. And so I think maybe if we really took like an average across the whole culture, that there are areas in which like that stigma is coming down and we see like more people coming into treatment. But that's not true everywhere or in every context. So I think there's that level of stigma of like thinking that, you know, like kind of what you described, that in order to be in treatment, something has to be really wrong with you. Therefore, if you are in treatment, that means that that kind of marks you as somebody who has a big problem. And then there's the other kind of stigma, which is like that bad therapy exists and that in some ways, like there is this real power dynamic within the therapeutic alliance, right? Between the client and the therapist, and that and you know, like really sadly, that there are people that take advantage of that, and they're you have a whole range from on the really horrible end of people who take advantage and actually like really hurt people, and then like all the way down, you can think of it sort of as a continuum to like maybe people who are doing things that like aren't very effective, which I think is still unethical. Like people are coming in paying money and doing something that isn't maybe like getting them anywhere. So that there's sort of like this range of like unhelpful behavior that happens in therapy, and that there might be some stigma towards like psychotherapy because of that. But I think that's a different stigma than the one that is saying that there's something wrong with people who go, because it marks them as somebody who's not functioning well or like something like that.
Well, it's obviously a very cultural thing too. Like I know I anecdotally, don't quote me on this. I mean, I guess this is live and blah, blah, blah. But, you know, no, I've heard that, like, for example, in Germany, if you do go to therapy, it does mark you in terms of insurance as, like, belonging to a different class of people, which is really, you know, like, and it's strange. I mean, it's a very strange kind of idea to work through. But I'm curious for you. I brought up this kind of EMDR example before, which I have to say, I mean, I read when I read the Bessel van der Kolk book, I mean, I first heard this podcast with him, with Krista Tippett, and, you know, he talked about EMDR, and I was like, that sounds, that sounds crazy in a good way. Like, that sounds, wow. And so then I bought the book, and I read the chapter on EMDR, and it blew my mind. It was a little bit like magic. But I know that you might feel very differently about this, so I'm just curious, like, what's your take on it?
Okay, so like, I was trained as like a cognitive behavioral therapist. So I was trained in that tradition. So there's like a few different kinds of treatment that come out of that. You can think about like the basic model underlying this is that we have, you know, like you can think of these things in a kind of triangle that we got like thoughts, feelings, and behaviors. And that it's really, really hard to change your feelings. If you're feeling awful all the time, you're feeling scared and you can't like do things that you used to be able to do, it's almost like impossible to change that on your own. If it were possible to just say like, I don't want to feel this way anymore, so I'm not going to, then therapists would be entirely unneeded. But that's not the case. It's really, really hard to change how you're feeling. But because we know that our thoughts, feelings, and behaviors, that they all influence each other. So in other words, the way that we think about something, if I think, for example, when I do this this talk with Prem, all these people are going to be judging me. They're going to be looking at me, and they're going to think badly of me. Maybe they'll think badly of me because they're all in the art world, and I chose to leave. And what will they think? How is that going to make me act? That's going to make me feel bad. It's going to make it harder for me to access the thoughts that I'm trying to have. It's going to make it harder for me to like, you know, talk openly and honestly. So it's going to affect both how I feel and how I behave. Similarly, what I do is also going to change how I think and how I feel. Let's say that I am somebody who is really anxious about public speaking. If I then avoid going, you know, talking publicly ever, I never get a chance to learn something new, which is, you know, maybe I would learn if I engaged in public speaking, but like, it's not so scary after all, and that maybe like I can do an okay job. And so that behavior also will change how I think and how I feel. And so because these things are all interconnected, what that tells us is that we can work on how we're thinking or how we're behaving, and thankfully that can change how we feel. That was like a long answer. To get back to the question about EMDR, there's different ways to approach like these, you know, problems that people have as a result of trauma. One is to change your behavior, another is to change the way that you think. EMDR is probably doing a little bit of both. The reason that EMDR is somewhat controversial in the world of psychology has not to do so much with what the question of if it's effective. It's effective. It's just that some people think that, so I've been trained in the two like gold standard types of treatment for trauma, which are prolonged exposure therapy and cognitive processing therapy. Prolonged exposure therapy is really getting at that behavior kind of node. Where you are changing. So like if somebody was hit by a car and then they have PTSD after that, they might avoid that road. They might avoid that intersection or that place where they were hit. And so you would target that behavior, and you would also target them avoiding to think about that memory. So that would be, you know, like focusing on the behavior. Another way to heal is to focus on how you're thinking about things. So cognitive processing therapy focuses on thoughts. And you might really look at how you interpret that event and then start to challenge some of those thoughts, which might be keeping you stuck in that trauma rather than allowing you to heal. My guess is that EMDR is doing a little bit of both of those things. And the reason that it's controversial is not that whether or not it works, but it's more because in order to learn to provide EMDR, you have to pay a lot of money. That it's sort of been monetized in a way that these other two treatments have not. It's totally free to learn the other ones. So the people who created prolonged exposure therapy, so Edna Foa and others, and the people who created cognitive processing therapy, which is like Kate Chard, and I'm like blanking on the main woman in this moment, but it'll come back to me. They provided their treatments for free for anyone to learn. And some people would say that EMDR is kind of like prolonged exposure therapy, but with like accessories, like with the like wands to do the eye movement and like all this stuff. And so that it's kind of just like, of course it worked, because like, you know, anything that worked, it's like, if you just add bells and whistles, it's still going to work because the principles are the same. I think van der Kolk tries to like address that a little bit in his book, but I don't know, because I've never been trained in EMDR. So I mean,
what you're saying also sounds, it's like, it's almost like, I don't want to, I'm an outsider in this. It's like, I don't want to like misuse the word cult, but it's almost like the fact that you have to pay to do a thing that seems to be like magic to normal folk like me, that you could just like think about a traumatic memory, somebody moves their hand like this and suddenly you're totally cured, seems like a little crazy. But I did want to, I mean, the thing that I wanted to ask about too is like this connection. I mean, the point you made about thinking, feeling, and behaviors, it's almost like this thing about, you know, one of the points that von der Kolk makes is like, he's a really, what I do admire about him is that he's very open-minded about different kinds of therapy. Like he's not dogmatic about one versus the other. And like, he's like, you know, yoga can be better than taking drugs or something. You know, I don't know. Like he has all this stuff about movement, and I'm curious about how you feel about that. Like
the role. Really interesting work about like embodied psychology. There are like experiments where they have people use different postures to do things, and they find differences in like how they perform as a result of like how you're sitting and stuff like that. So I think there's like something to it. I just don't know, but he's right. He's right in that like there's so many different kinds of treatments that have been shown to be effective for trauma. Like like I said, the two that I described are kind of like the considered gold standard, but there's IPT, interpersonal therapy, which is like more where you work on like how you relate to other people. That's been shown to be effective. There's even like this like horse therapy that's being like used right now with veterans. And I know some of the people involved with that, and that's really working. And that's like really where you literally just go and hang out with horses. And apparently horses are extremely sensitive to what people do. So like much more than like other people. And so the horse reflects like on a really kind of like a big, huge screen. The horse is kind of like this huge emotional reflection of how people are behaving, and people can learn to change how they're responding to stuff, people with PTSD, based on how the horse is responding to them. So yeah, there's like a wide array of like really out, like what might be considered out there treatments that have been shown to be effective.
Well, the thing that is also, I mean that's something that I also admire also in what you're talking about, that there are all of these ways. I mean, it's something von der Kolk also talks about. I don't want to just be talking about von der Kolk, though I am like his main proselytizer, it seems. But yeah. it's the fact that like there are all of these different things that actually have really remarkable results to make people feel better about things that are challenging to them. And it's just that they might not be accepted into a certain canon, but they may have some uses. I wanted to change tacks for a moment, just like as a, you know, I mean, one of the, you know, as I said, one of the weird things is that we've actually known each other for something like 25 years. And you may have even been there for some of those, like, you know, slightly traumatic experiences that I related of being in art school, and why I like ran away from institutions of higher education as fast as I could when I was done. But I'm just curious, like in the spirit of critique, I'm just curious, like, what did you think seeing like you probably haven't seen anything I've made in like 25 years. Like what was that like? What would your like, you know, more, maybe not like the most brutal version of Rip Me Down and Make Me Cry, but like if you had to critique some of what you heard before, what would your take on it be?
Meaning like the slides or?
Yeah, or this whole thing. Like, what do you think about this whole thing? You're like not in this game anymore. So you have a nice outsider's perspective.
Like this format of like, or.
You are being a good therapist. You're like asking what I want you to critique rather than just railing in with like, what the hell is this stuff? But I don't know. I'm just curious. What's your take on this? Like being in this situation, seeing these things, like what do you make of it from outside of the art world?
I think it's a beautiful thing to try to pull people together to talk on a theme, and like having now sat through the other talks and really enjoyed them and feeling like I've gotten so much out of them and seeing like the threads, like how they come together. I think it's like a very generous thing to kind of pull this thing together and try to create community in a time when people are experiencing a lot more isolation. So I think that's really lovely.
I think. But what's the but?
I was thinking, because when we, you know, like you spoke, I feel, so here's the question that I have. The reason that I was asking, I was trying to like pull out something out of you, is that I wonder, like a lot of the slideshow was these images of the text, but they weren't, so you had, there were choices, right? Like you could just type up that text and slap it in a PowerPoint, but instead you chose these like very beautifully lit photographs that have your hand in it sometimes, and it's kind of almost more of an illustration of what it's like to read rather than just being about the text. And so I'm curious, do you think of those as your photography?
Okay, yeah, nailing it at the core. let's say it's a very good question. It is the right question, I think, in that case. I mean, the honest truth is that I think I started to take photographs like that in January. After being at Yale and all that stuff, like I for years wanted to call myself a photographer or an artist, and I then kind of didn't or couldn't do it, and became a graphic designer and have done a lot of other stuff. And I think in January before COVID, I started to take photographs of books. I actually had this whole session with my therapist where I was like, am I allowed to do this? Like, I'm taking photographs, am I really, I don't want to call myself an artist. And it was a kind of this terrifying moment. And then I had a friend who's an artist, Matthew Hale, an artist and photographer whom I really admire, come to my studio, and I showed him these photographs, and I was terrified. I was like, oh my God, and then he kind of just rolled with it and didn't even worry about whether they were, I don't know, he didn't worry about whether they were artworks or not. He was just like, oh, that's really cool. You're reading these books. And we had a conversation. And then I kind of built them into a talk and a book that I did that became the very first present event. I built them in, and it was my way of sneaking photographs into a thing. But then I think over the last couple months, I mean, since I started working on different versions of that slideshow, I think I kind of got rid of the idea of caring whether it was art or not, because I realized that the point is that I'm trying to talk with folks about what I think art can do and healing and creativity and the role. And so in some ways I don't need to call myself an artist. It's that's not important. But I can take photographs, and maybe those will be more evocative or emotional than just reading a text aloud. And in any case, whether or not it is more or less evocative, it's just the way I do things. And I can just kind of make that part of what I do without worrying about what I call it. But that's my kind of I would have been ripped to fucking shreds if I had said that in a crit in college, I'm sure.
Good question. I think it's an interesting question, what the purpose of that is, the purpose of those crits. Is it about getting you to be able to talk about the work more effectively, for when you leave, I guess? I have no idea, but it's a good question, because I feel like when you see, because I worked for a lot of artists for many years, and so I saw, and of course you work for the people who have the most kind of economic success and therefore can pay you. So you see kind of how they're doing and what's going on. And I feel there's actually, it's almost when you're at that kind of upper echelon of the folks who are making a ton of money from art, they're definitely not talking about their work. Nobody's asking them to justify it. And if anything, they're really hesitant to say too much about it, because the whole thing is that it kind of, their work needs to be kind of whatever the buyer wants it to be, in a way. And so there's it's interesting, because it's an interesting kind of hazing process or whatever, because at the lowest level you have these students and you're asking them to justify all the time what they're doing, rationalize it. And then, but then once you get out into the world and you're at this place where the work is monetized, then all of a sudden that's almost a thing that you shouldn't do if you want to make money. I don't know.
That's so, I mean, That is totally fucking true. That's so crazy. I mean, you're right. You learn in art school to how to talk about and defend your work. And I mean, I'm convinced that, anyways, we could talk about this for hours, but I'm convinced it's about cycles of trauma. I mean, it's convinced that it's those folks were traumatized by people in art school, their professors who were worried they were stepping on their toes, and so they had to constantly destroy them. And then they learned to do that to their students. And it's what happens in the architecture profession and the design profession. And in these cycles of ripping people apart. And I don't know. I mean, that's actually why I do think, as cheesy as it sometimes can be, the artist way is really useful, because it's hey, you actually just have to, as Ari was saying, you have to figure out what to make
and, you know, what, how you want to make it, regardless of how other people are going to see it. And that doesn't mean that you can't be self-critical and you can't have a sense of quality or a sense of your own standards, but it means like you shouldn't have to follow. It also connects so well with what Kameelah was talking about with Emily Dickinson. Like, you know, you have to like make your own systems. But well, I it's so nice to also have this odd context to reconnect in front of a bunch of folks. But well, I did want to just end. I want to say that, like, you know, the last way that I really knew you, the first way I really knew you was that you were in a band called the Pollo Kids, with a song called Iguana. Do you remember Iguana? Like, that was, and also the weird thing is that you and Darby Saxby, who was your co-band member, didn't Darby become a neuroscientist? Like,
but she's a clinical psychologist too.
Like what the hell? All the folks I knew in college became clinical psychologists. It's totally weird. So, well, I wanted to, I thought that maybe you would join me in a brief ritual that is, you know, part of what we always do here. If I can make this work, oh man, maybe I can't make this work. What's going on? We have a couple of, I believe very much in rituals. And one of them is that we tend to have a little bit of group karaoke at some point. So I wanted to see if you might join us in this for a moment.
Absolutely.
Let's see if we can get the audio to work. Wait, I'm gonna just check this one more time. I'm gonna check it twice before you do it. Please, everyone, I'd also encourage you, one of the great things about group karaoke on Zoom is that it's way out of sync and weird. So anybody who wants, turn on your audio. Feel free to turn on your audio and you can just join in and be part of the out of sync fun. Got it? Mm-hmm. Okay, let's start it now.
It was working.
Wait, is there music?
Yeah, it was working.
Wait, was there music?
Yes.
Okay, see, Emily was like saying over here, she was like, no, there's no music. So she wasn't getting it. But if you all heard it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, let's try it again. That was just like every karaoke is a rehearsal for another karaoke. All right, let's try it one more time. Sorry about that. Y'all ready? Now you're geared up. Everyone's got their audio on and we can have a little bit of fun. Give me a thumbs up if it's working.
No.
It stopped. Oh. So you can't do that. Oh man. Okay. You gotta read the lyrics. In case you don't know, I'll be the wind, the rain, and the sunset, the light on your soul, to show you that you're home. When you think the night has seen your mind, that inside your tent is dead and kind, let me stand to show you that you're mine. Please put down your hand. I find it hard to believe you don't know the beauty of your life. Do. Yeah, see, that's it. Exactly.
That was hilarious.
They might. You know, this might be the only episode of Present that happened this season. Let's see what Front thinks. I thank you so much, Tamara. Thanks for doing that and for being part of it. I want to bring back on Kameelah Janan Rasheed. Where are you, Kameelah? Are you there?
I'm here.
Yay! Kameelah has been busily making. We've given her a little bit more time than we expected. Thank you.
Never give me more time than is necessary, because I'll go crazy. Okay, so I'm going to share my screen. This was a lot of fun. So thank you, guys threw me for a loop. So I made a screen recording of the whole process, which took exactly 37 minutes and 36 seconds. So I'm gonna read the final piece, and then I'm gonna show the video of how we got there, just so we can see where we ended up. So I use all of the words, and everything in blue are either words or prefixes or suffixes that I added, but everything else are the words you guys gave me. So here's what the world is gonna look like. It's easy to control some groups with banners. Live bluntly, sprightly, yes, 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 yes. If you look back to September, the moving pieces softly sneeze, and the February trees delivered one happiness. A wild messenger dwelling on a spectrum, because the ocean is a healing curriculum. Our objective should be a durable and incandescent way to see good. A meditation that eases restriction. An anorexic contradiction corners the racism project, and public soldiers reconnect to a new set of priorities. The eternal outbursts ennoble and rekindle an unlikely satisfaction. A new movement composed direct freedom keyed to the right tone. Has the club improved? An antibacterial karaoke music, cranky past, uncontaminated by common kindness. We formulated an observable universe that is experienced through accessible software and displayed as metallic, rubber, and plastic patches. An invitation. No future wicked geographies who present alliances or criminality. My field notes are a digital portfolio of my fresh mind. Travel to the top and save Chicago. This came from you guys. This is literally from you guys. So in 37 minutes, that's where we ended up, which is kind of cool, which is why I love doing these. But I'm gonna speed through the video just so you guys can see my process. So basically I copy and pasted everything from the chat and then removed all the names and just had the text. And then as you can see, as you move through it, it's just me literally moving things around.
Wow. That's beautiful.
I was getting so nervous because as we were finishing the talk, I was trying to listen to the talk and do this at the same time. So I imagine some of the talk leaked into what eventually got created. But yeah, this was a lot of fun. And I want to say thank you to everyone who contributed words, because this was, I love writing, but I don't enjoy writing from a place of so-called inspiration. I don't like to sit down and just be like, I'm gonna write an essay now. It often starts with someone saying a word, or me hearing like a street preacher say something, or like listening to a song, or just like seeing a list of words. I'm like, oh, I should do something with it. So this is my writing process. And this was something that we collaboratively wrote, which is just absolutely beautiful. And one of the questions that Prem and I had at the beginning was like, what's the difference between collecting raw material, right, from a bunch of folks and then going away to do something, and my own little black box of just like going away to do something? What's the difference between that and doing what I've done a bit in the past, which is like collecting words and then like sitting with people for hours to make something and then presenting it? So yeah, I don't know. We have 2 minutes left, or now it's a minute. I'm looking at the clock. We don't have much time left, but I guess I just wanted to leave it there to sort of think about the ways in which collaboration can look, and how the restraint of time and the restraint of like just a certain set of words can actually like conjure something really beautiful. Yeah, I guess I'll just leave it there. I don't know, Prem, if you had a question or something you wanted to add or share.
Yeah. Well, no, I think it's amazing to see the, it's so great to also see the video of you making it. We had a question in the chat about whether you could share that. I don't know, we can talk about it. But I think because of time, what I want to say is that I think that you've opened up this big question of like, what does a collaborative process mean? What is the individual authorship? But as you said, like you yourself as a writer, you might not start from writing something, you start from asking people to contribute something. And so that becomes mm-hmm. part of this process. And I think it's interesting to kind of see each of ourselves in something like this in some ways, but also to see how it's made rather than just this finished process. And so I think what I'm gonna do, because of timing wise, is I'm gonna say that I think like, this is a conversation that starts here. I mean, it's amazing to see that there are a lot of folks who have stayed with us for almost the whole time. I mean, we're gonna continue in a month with another present, the last Friday of October. And I'd encourage you also, if you have questions, thoughts, and things, you can send them to us. Actually, I was supposed to do something that would put up, can I break your screen share for a second, Kameelah?
Well, absolutely. I'm going.
I'm gonna do this because I'm just going to, what I'm going to do is, I'm gonna put in, almost like a, what did I just do? I just did something wrong. But what I wanted to say was that, oh God, I'm always doing something wrong. So I wanted to say that I mean, I think of this as the start of a conversation rather than the end of a conversation. And so hopefully we will be able to, I'm again doing something wrong. Anyways, I wanted to say that hopefully this is the start rather than the end of a conversation. And so we can continue we can continue next time. We can continue. I hope this group almost might be a little community, a group of folks who start to know each other in different ways. So there is a link here, which is you can be on the list and we can continue, and you can also email us. I'll put a couple of emails here where if you have comments, thoughts, you can put them in, you can email us and we will gladly respond. But I wanna just take a moment then for two things. I want to take a moment, first of all, to thank all of the guests, to thank Kameelah, Ra, and Tamara for being so generous with your time and your thinking and really opening up your process to us. I wanna thank Front for making this possible. And I wanna thank all of you for taking a big chunk out of a weekend to be here with us. It's very meaningful. So I wanna just kind of end with two things. I want us to all, again, take three deep breaths in and out with each other. And one more. And I want you to take a moment and write one sentence of how you feel. I want you to just write a sentence of how you feel right now after having spent this time here in the chat. And while you're doing that, I'm going to cue up, just write a sentence of how you feel, and I'm gonna cue up one last thing, a song by Mourning a Black Star, a band that Ra Washington founded in Cleveland. A song of theirs called Flicker for us to listen to and maybe even dance to if you feel the spirit move you as we leave. Did I actually click the right buttons? No, I didn't. Somebody give me a thumbs up if you hear sound.
People. Millions of people whom you will never see, who don't know you, never will know you. People who may try to kill you in the morning. Live in a darkness which if you have that funny, terrible thing which every artist can recognize and no artist can define, you are responsible to those people to lighten that darkness, and it does not matter what happens to you. You are being used in the way a crab is useful, the way sand certainly has some function. It is impersonal. This force which you didn't ask for, and this destiny which you must accept, is also your responsibility. And if you survive it, if you don't cheat, if you don't lie, it is not only, you know, your glory, your achievement, it is almost our only hope.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, RA and Morning of Black Star for that. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Thanks for being with us. And we look forward to seeing you all in a month at the end of October. And be well, be safe, and be caring and loving for those around you. Thank you, everyone.
Peace.
Oh, my parents are there. Hey, how you doing? We just ended, but nice to see you. Hey, Carol.
Okay, good.
All right, this is like the family stays. All right, bye, Tamara. Bye, everyone. Bye, thank you. All right, see you all soon.
Bye, Emily.
Bye, Prem, okay. Emily, everyone.
Okay, I'm gonna end this jam.